The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter. Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So two people are praying in the temple, but only one of them goes home justified, that is, in good standing with God. One of them is a Pharisee, a good man, not a crook, not unfaithful to his spouse, good to his friends, treats others fairly. He's not like the tax collector, who is a genuine crook, because this tax collector has a legal franchise from the Romans to collect money from his fellow Jews, who the Romans may be having trouble finding anyway, and who probably speak a language the Romans don't even know. And he's allowed to collect all the money that he can from his own countrymen as long as he pays the Romans a flat fee. So the Pharisee wants to do the best he can to obey the religious law of his tradition. He's not a hypocrite. I mean, he's the real deal. He fasts twice a week. He gives 10% off the top. He goes to church all the time and thanks God for his happy life. If you can find a couple dozen people like that, have them call me. We could use some members. But that's the problem, because Jesus is telling us that not only is this good man in bad shape before God, but he is actually in worse shape than the crook of a tax collector who is about as rotten as they come. Now, from a churchy point of view, you and I really don't have any problem when God sends this tax collector home justified. I mean, he prayed the right prayer. I mean, he made it happen in the right way. He was humble before God, while the Pharisee was rather self-satisfied. Right? I mean, we don't have any problem with that. But let's see if we can figure out what Jesus may really be telling us here. What if this tax collector changed nothing about his crooked life and then came back the next week singing the same song, God have mercy on me, a sinner? And then he came back the third week without having changed anything about his life. And the fourth week, God have mercy on me, a sinner. And what if each week God kept sending him home justified? You're with me on this, right? I mean, are we good church people that are going to put up with that? Of course not. We're going to cry foul. It's not right for this crook to get away with that. God would never put up with that. But from where Jesus sits, if this tax collector is not going to change his wicked ways, then neither is God going to change his divine ways. And this guy is going to go home justified each week. Is it now the right time to bring up the fact that we have confession every week? Okay, well, I realize I may have annoyed you at this point. But try it this way, then, if that doesn't work for you. Suppose that the tax collector comes back the next week and says that he has reformed a bit. Maybe he didn't cheat people quite as badly as the week before, and instead made a big contribution to the temple. Well, good for him, we say. Maybe he's going to be okay after all. But from Jesus' point of view, why would God accept his short list of good things when God has already rejected the good Pharisee's long list of things? Do you see what it is that Jesus is doing here? We all play the game called, "Where do I stand with God?" And Jesus is saying this tax collector goes home justified because he knows that he has already lost that game. And if he's going to have any standing before God at all, God is going to have to tell him what it is. The Pharisee, though, thinks that the way that he's been living will keep him in the game for quite a long time. But God is not interested in depending on our good deeds to hold up through eternity. Eventually, a revealing video will show up. Eventually, emails will be uncovered. The truth about every one of us is all on tape. This is metaphorical language. At the cross, as Jesus died, God declared once and for all that where we stand with God is a gift and nothing but a gift. And from Jesus' empty tomb, God is promising that it really is true. Because resurrection is the ultimate proclamation of where you stand with God. The word resurrection actually means to stand up again. And so you're standing, it's good standing. And the promise is that what God has done for Jesus, God will do for us all. So if you and God are playing a game of who's good enough, according to Jesus, you've already lost. And maybe the worst part is that the Pharisee is never going to be able to really enjoy himself in life because he's still keeping track of the things that God isn't counting anymore. And I do that too. It's much better to have a free lunch and go home justified. Yay! Both the Pharisee and the tax collector have lost the game, and where they stand before God has nothing to do with them. It has everything to do with God. Because you see, God's whole idea of sending Jesus among us was not to make us better, but to make us belong to him. And Jesus' cross and resurrection has done just that. We are God's now and forever, not through any fault of our own. Where we stand before God is a game we've lost, but for the life of me, it's a game I just can't stop playing. For sure, we'll all stop playing when we're dead. And when we're dead, the only thing that's left will be the grace of God, which we often resisted by continuing to play the game. And that's all we can know about resurrection. The rest, while we live, is faith. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Set free by the truth of God's gracious love, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of God's good creation. Only you are righteous, O God. Lead your church to true repentance, so that we reflect your light and truth to the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Only you can bring rain, O God. Be with those who lack clean water or must walk miles to